Okay, the same thing's going to be true about a perennial Centranthus rubra. This is a wonderful drought-tolerant plant. And I'm going to teach you something about it today that will change your life. The common name for Centranthus rubra is Jupiter's beard. Why? I'm not seeing any resemblance to Jupiter, and I see no beard. Boy, the things that people name plants, I have no idea. Nonetheless, this grows and blooms, doesn't it? And as it grows and blooms, what's the next thing it does after it gets done blooming?
Seeds.
And those seeds, of course, hardly ever come up anywhere, right? Okay. What else happens after it gets bloom? It blooms and seeds and what?
They do it again.
Flops.
Yeah.
Flops. And then done flowering pretty much till the following cool season, right? Cut it down. Every time that it gets done blooming, and preferably before it starts producing a million seeds, cut it down just to a couple of inches. And do you know what? Within 5 weeks out in your garden, it's going to be right back. Beautiful new foliage, beautiful new flowers, and we keep our Jupiter's beard blooming all spring, all summer, all fall. Finally, fall, it goes back a little bit to vegetative, but always looking fresh and nice instead of that flop. Yes, ma'am.
So I want to know what you use to sharpen your knives.
Oh, so the lady wants to know what I use to sharpen my knives. Well, this is something that was childhood education 101. See, when I went to school, if you showed up without a knife, you would get thrown out of school. Every kid had a pocket knife, right? And so we learned how to take care of our knives and things like that. This particular knife is a fantastic knife because it's serrated. And so it will cut through difficult things like grass. Okay? And that, you know, when you're trying to cut through a clump of grass, you can't take clippers necessarily, and a regular knife doesn't cut through them, but this nice serration cuts through them. Now, before any of you start hooking up with the injury lawsuit attorneys, I want to give you a little warning. The warning goes like this. When I was 17 and a half years old, I started my first job at Heinz Wholesale Nursery. And at that time, I was the smartest human being in the world. Okay? And so my boss, who was giving me an orientation, having to work through this 500-acre nursery, one of the two largest wholesale nurseries in the world at that time, my boss, who's in charge of the propagation area, told me that today and for the next 2 weeks, we're going to go out and we're going to take cuttings of star jasmine. And he handed me these little clippers, and he said, "Don't cut yourself." Don't cut myself. Are you kidding? Who do you think I am? I am the smartest human being in the world. So, I'm out there cutting star jasmine. You reach behind clip, reach behind clip, reach behind clip. Your movements have to be fast, you have to be efficient, you have to produce like 30,000 cuttings a day, and I'm reach behind clip, reach behind clip, reach the finger behind and pop like a grape. And those words, those prescient words, those words of the most incredible wisdom known to man came back to me. And I heard coming out of the sky in this deep ringing voice, "Don't cut yourself." Okay, I'm going to tell you the same thing about this. It's very easy to get excited about how well this works. Get in there. You're holding your clump of grass. You're sawing through and going, "That is amazing. That's cutting right through the grass." Okay, I don't want that to happen. Be careful. Don't cut yourself. These can be purchased at Smart and Final Iris. This is the best nursery outdoor working knife that you'll ever find in your life. Now, personally, I found my first one. I was doing a little bit of landscaping work at O.J. Simpson's residence years ago. And I was out there working, and I found this knife underneath the bushes, and I picked it up, and I looked at it, and I said, "I wonder why somebody would throw away a perfectly good knife." And so that's when I, you know, and they have the nice serrations on it. It's been a good knife ever since. But you can get them at Smart and Final Iris. And they're really not very expensive. Okay? Now, the next thing that I do to sharpen knives after that is eventually these teeth will get dull. So, of course, in my garage, I have a grinding wheel, Fred Flintstone style, except that it's got an electric motor on it. So I will take and I will grind one side, not both sides. I'll find the tapered side. There's a tapered side and a flat side. So I'll take the tapered side and just flash grind it and get it sharp again, all those little edges. After a few times, it wears those teeth off. Then I will take it very carefully and probably not safe, check your equipment manual, and I'll zinc it in and create new teeth and then recreate a whole new serrated blade.
With safety goggles, right?
With safety goggles.
I will leave that to your imagination. You should wear safety goggles when you do that. Okay, so ornamental grasses, going to be the same as perennials we just looked at. Okay, daylilies. Going to be exactly the same as the iris we just looked at, except it doesn't have a sideways rhizome, but it still doesn't like to be planted too deep. This one, the petals fell off while I drove over. It's actually a big, beautiful new yellow variety that's fragrant. Smells like perfume. Smells like a lily. Oh, it is a lily. But I mean, it smells like a lily. So this is a new variety of daylily that you can only get it from us. We introduced this to the trade. It's called Quick Results. And it blooms about 9 to 10 months out of the year. And I'm not going to chop it up because it'll be a little nicer to give away as a free plant. Okay? All right. This is a daylily called Lightning Berry. Lightning Berry has juicy, fruity colored flower petals on it and a white stripe down the middle of each petal, like a lightning bolt. So this is another really beautiful and great daylily. Now I'm going to give you a little pointer about daylilies. Remember I gave you a pointer about Jupiter's beard? I'm going to give you a pointer about daylilies. Daylilies, good daylilies, bloom for about 6 to 9 months out of the year. Daylilies that you get from anywhere else, especially brought over from catalogs out of the southeast, bloom about 10 minutes in the spring. Okay? But good daylilies, our line of good evergreen daylilies, bloom 6 to 9 months out of the year. There are two times a year when they bloom the least, and that would be the hottest part of summer and the coldest part of winter. They're taking a little bit of a blooming break, okay? So at that time of the year, that's your golden opportunity to...
Whack it off.
Oh, that looks good.
And now, what did I do? If you do that to the whole clump with a weed eater, with a lawnmower, with a whatever, chainsaw, I love using my 36-inch Husqvarna chainsaw, which don't ever do, and it's not in the manual, and you will be hurt horribly. Maimed for life. But if you do that and cut it down to about this height, you'll never have yellow leaves anymore to pick out one by one. You'll get almost all the flower stems all at once, one by one. Now, you could do that any time of year. The only reason I tell you is to wait for the hottest part of summer or the coldest part of winter is because that way you're not cutting off a lot of beautiful flower stems and emerging flowers. We actually cut them down a lot of times a year just because we've got to keep the crops fresh and young and compact and tight. But that's daylily maintenance. Cut it to the ground. Yes, ma'am.
Would it be a good time to do now?
It's a wonderful time now. August, hottest part of summer. Because, see, when you cut them down to the ground now, good daylily varieties that you would get from Waterwise Botanicals that are rebloomers and great evergreen selections are preparing to set up their whole new bloom cycle, rebloom cycle for fall. And they think it's spring again when the cool weather starts coming in the end of September, and they'll bloom all the way into December. Yes, ma'am.
We've always been taught that bulbs, you leave the leaves on to produce the energy for regrowth.
That is true for bulbs that go deciduous and that have a deciduous period. So when you're talking about, and did everybody hear that? She said we've always been told that bulbs, you leave the leaves on so they can photosynthesize and produce food, energy, and sugars down into the bulb. That's for bulbs that have a deciduous season. In other words, they're green for spring and summer, and then they die down to the ground, and they have to reserve and store that energy for winter. But see, daylilies, and you're right, because you go back east in the Midwest, and the daylilies die to the ground. But they're actually very efficient storers of energy. But the thing is when I cut it down to this short, do you know that in 5 weeks it's going to be this tall again? They literally grow a half an inch a day. Go ahead. Get out your little ruler. Measure it. Half an inch a day. I'm not exaggerating. I've never been known to exaggerate. But in this case, I'm not. Okay? So it really freshens them up. They come back beautiful. Sometimes you might want to fertilize them a week ahead of time. Just some additional nitrogen, you know, get that in there, get it in their system. Then a week later, whack them down. It'll look like you spilled the whole box of corn seed in one spot with all those fresh new green leaves coming up.
Wow.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
One of the things I found out about Planting Society garlic and Biden's is that if you don't want the smell, don't plant it where when people walk through your garden, they brush up all against it.
Oh, did you hear that? Yeah.
Because
the front door.
Yeah.
Put it where it's pretty to see,
right.
Not where it's brushed up against.
Right. Now, so she said one thing she found out about Tolbagia and Biden's daisy is don't plant it where people are going to be walking through constantly, and then they don't rustle up the smell. But if you don't have a watchdog, you could have a smell plant so that you're laying in bed at night and you start going, whoa, I better call the cops. Hello, 911, my plant just discovered a person sneaking around my house. What's another great smell one, by the way? Tagetes.
Yes.
The marigold.
Oh,
you love it?
Yeah.
See, it's a love-hate thing. Some people go, oh, I love it. And other people go, get it away from me. Tagetes is very strong. Yeah. Would you buy a perfume that smelled like that? No? So do you really love it? This was almost like a polygraph test. Okay. Okay, so we've got a few more things that we'll go through real quick. One of the most difficult things to work with in a bare root format, of course, are the succulents. So I was walking along in the nursery, and this branch of a little aeonium that we call Green Crush had fallen off of the trailer about 6.5 months ago and was laying alongside the road, and it was just a stem at that time that broke off, and it lives its life bare root. You see, the roots have never touched the soil yet. They're just hanging there, hanging around. If a little bit of moisture comes by, they breathe it in, suck it in, sense it, and the plant is still alive. That's how hard it is to work with succulents and get them to bear root, or root, or root barely, or barely root. Okay, so, I mean, we all know that, right? Succulents, it's kind of funny. It's just kind of funny. Because you'll set a piece of a succulent on a shelf or on a table in the patio in the shade, and you'll walk back out 3 months later, and there's little pink roots growing on it.
3 months.
Yes, sir.
3 days.
But I mean still.
Yeah. Yeah.
Holding power.
Yeah.
Okay, you're right. So, Deborah Lee Baldwin, a dear friend of ours, and who is frequently at our succulent celebration events as an author and speaker. And by the way, if any of you missed succulent celebration this year, you were one of 3,000 people that didn't. 3,000 people showed up and you didn't.
Wow.
We had a lot of fun. We do each year. We have a fall celebration coming up that's called Fall Garden Party. It's not like succulent celebration. It's a little more toned down. It's going to be actually after all of the pumpkin people and stuff do their thing, because fall in Southern California comes in early November. So if you have a chance, join us. Start watching the announcements on the website and Facebook about Fall Garden Party. The announcements will be coming out within a week, and we have crazy fun stuff lined up to do. And it's great to get together. Usually several hundred people show up. And so that means they're still parking inside of the gate instead of all up and down the highway, like on Succulent Celebration. But Deborah Lee Baldwin took a little rosette of an echeveria, a hens and chick type plant, and she cut it off at the stem. It was actually an attractive one. It wasn't quite, this little variety is called Green Goddess, and it's okay, but it's not like one of those pink ones or something. And she took that little rosette, and she took a chopstick or something like that, and she wired and wrapped it on and made a flower on a stem out of it for putting in arrangements. She stuck that in an empty little bottle, no water in it, of course, because chopsticks don't suck water up to a plant. And she put it on her back patio in the shade back in the year 2012 and a half. Been 18 months the rosette is still alive on her little stick. Mm. Oh, once every couple of months or so she thinks about it, she might squirt a little mist on it. Mm. Isn't that amazing? Okay, so you can put them in your hat.
There.
You can put them in your lapel. Mm-hmm. You can even put them in a pair of old women's high heels, mm-hmm. and then your husband will come up and say, "Darling, I love your succulent toes."
Mm-hmm. Oh.
That's pretty much all there is to it. So, now that we learned how, I brought a very special plant to you today. This is a brand new introduction to the trade. It has a brother, maybe a sister, not quite sure, called the plush plant, Echeveria harmsii. But Echeveria harmsii, the plush plant, the regular one, has lighter colors, kind of pink and bronzy tints, and orange flowers. This is a brand new cultivar that we're introducing to the trade. It actually was an opener at Succulent Celebration 2014, and it's called Ruby Slippers because its ruby color is way, way more intense. And in fact, it looks fairly ruby-ish right now. But in the wintertime, that intensifies even more in the leaf colors. And then the flower, instead of being orange, has these great ruby tints to it as well. This is a succulent that is unlike most little windowsill succulents that you see and get, because most little windowsill succulents that you see and get are not good landscape plants. They're good in pots and windowsills and things like that, but they're not durable in the landscape. This is actually a little succulent shrub that never gets taller than about 8 to 10 inches, but it'll grow wider and wider over time, maybe up to 2 feet wide. It will be there decades after you planted it. It's a solid, permanent, succulent shrub, and it keeps flowering year-round. Okay, so the problem is this. It's like when I had my hair long and I was doing a lot of glamour shots as a male model, and I used to tell people, "Don't hate me because I am beautiful." It's the same problem with this. It flowers so much that becomes its one drawback, because every now and then you have to trim the flowers off. Now, we all have things to do, so I don't want to see any of you out there picking one little branch at a time, which you can, unless you want that touchy-feely nature experience. But I just want to let you know that you can get the chainsaw and just zip right across the top, and it doesn't matter if you nick the leaves a little bit, and boom, it'll be all fresh and beautiful, and new flower stems will start coming out within a couple to a few weeks. And you got the whole job done, because we actually have a band of these planted on the slope that is 160 feet long by 25 feet wide. And all we've got to do is take the big power head shears and go zip, and we're done, and they're all cleaned up, and the new flowers come back.
How far are you cutting down?
How far am I cutting down? Right down to the tops of the good leaves. And like I said, it's, don't worry, don't go, "I don't want to get close because I'm going to nick the little leaf." Don't worry, it's going to grow right back in a few weeks. No worries. But you kind of want to leave this nice foliage part, which is permanent, stays there. But if you hurt it or cut it back too far, it's going to grow right back. Don't worry about it. Don't worry, be happy now. Relax. Okay? That's all there is to it. Echeveria harmsii ruby slippers. At the opening, when this was first introduced, its introductory phase, just like the new bra from Victoria's Secret, it cost $20 in this size pot. Now that the aura has gone away, it's regular price just like all of our other succulents. And you can get this for about $7 at the nursery. Or you can get it today for about $7. Okay? Echeveria harmsii ruby slippers. That is a beautiful plant. I love it. Now, the thing about succulents is they're so easy to propagate and reproduce that things got out of control and out of hand, and we decided to put a stop to it. So what we did is we have been working with genetic engineers who have encoded in the DNA of these plants a way of growing a little microchip in the growing point of each stem. So that when you, or you, or you and you and you, take a cutting and you stick it in the ground, it has a sensor. And as soon as the base of that stem starts to grow new roots, the sensor detects that and it sends a message back up to the microchip, which then sends a signal up to a satellite, which automatically deducts $5 out of your bank account. So don't do it. Rooting hormones. Let's talk about hormones.
Yes.
First we talked about sexuality, now we're going to talk about hormones. Rooting hormones. For the most part, that's done just when you're working with actual stems. If there's already some root development, it doesn't help and it's entirely unnecessary. Rooting hormones are only for the purpose of telling little cells that are normally stem cells or leaf cells or bud cells to change your game and actually become a root cell. Okay? But if there's root tissue already there, you're not helping the process at all. No reason to apply it. Okay? When you're using rooting hormones, really about the only thing that it's necessary for, useful for, is if you're working with hardwood cuttings. You know, like maybe you wanted to take a cutting of your Indian hawthorn or your pittosporum or all those things that nobody grows anymore and we don't carry at our nursery because we have all cool new stuff. Okay? You can't find the stuff that all the nurseries have at our nursery. But that's the kind of thing you would use rooting hormone for. We actually do use rooting hormone when we root our rose cuttings. Mm-hmm. Yes, all of our roses are rooted on their own roots. That's not how it's done. Normally they're grafted. Do you know why we don't graft our roses? Because I get a D- in grafting in my entire horticultural career. I have been known to kill more hundreds of thousands of plants by trying to graft than almost any other person in the profession. And so we had to learn how to root our roses. And frankly, on some varieties, that's pretty darn easy. And on other varieties, it's really, really difficult. But the good result of a rose that's rooted on its own roots is it never grows up from underneath, where you hack off that sucker, and now you have 3, and you hack those off, and now you have 5, and you hack those off, and now you have 20, and it's a thorny battle, okay? But the other thing is a rose that is not grafted can live to be hundreds of years old and be an heirloom plant because it's never overrun by the rootstock or the graft never fails on it as time goes by. So roses that are on their own roots have this heirloom capacity that you might have planted it in your yard and archaeologists came along one day and found a plastic spoon that they had no idea what it was next to this ancient hundreds of years old rose plant that's growing there in your backyard. Wouldn't that be cool? Okay, so that's the rooting thing. Okay, let's talk about vitamins. Vitamins. Mm-hmm. Do you like the gummy bear vitamins or the traditional ones that you swallow with a glass of water? What we're talking about here is B1, mm-hmm. right? You can go down to the retail nursery and buy vitamin B1. This, again, is an indication as to why I don't get any sponsors. Frankly, I think it's worthless. Doesn't do a bit of good, doesn't seem to help. Makes you feel good, though, because you feel like you're doing something. But frankly, in the commercial world, we never use anything like it. Anytime I've ever used it, it's like, I don't know. Okay, your choice. If it makes you feel good, do it. I'm talking about vitamin B1 and plants. Okay, mm-hmm. That's it. Okay, now I'm going to just show you a couple of last plants, and one of those really quickly will be Gara. The butterfly bush, or perennial, actually. Gara, again, is a plant that will grow flat. It's got a winter foliage, and it grows its leaves flat to the ground. And then when spring comes, emerge with these flower stems that come way up, bloom like crazy. It's beautiful. And then they either go like this and start tangling up to look like a tumbleweed, or they split in the middle and flop outwards. Cut it down. I cut my garas down 2 or 3 times a year. As soon as they stop looking, that beautiful fountain of little butterfly flowers, whack.
How far down?
Like almost always, about as close to the ground as you can get without chopping off a sprinkler riser or something. Yes, ma'am.
The question is on the seeding of these plants. When they send off their seed, their millions and millions of seeds.
Yes.
Do you cut them down before they do that?
Okay, so her question was, what about all these plants that go to seed, like Centranthus, like Gara sometimes, and some of those? Do you cut them down before they start producing all those seeds? Absolutely. If you want to stop the flow of a very abundant supply of seeds, you know, by the time they flower, there's a ripening period of usually a couple to a few weeks. So you don't even need to wait for every single last flower to bloom. Like I say, when it just starts looking a little rangy, or when I see the very first seeds starting to develop, which you can see on Centranthus, because it's a little feather that starts floating around, whack, cut it down. You don't need that, you know? Ain't nobody got time for all them seeds. Okay? Which brings us to ornamental grasses. A lot of ornamental grasses are flipping invasive. It can be a real problem, right? So that's why you won't find hardly any grasses at our nursery that are invasive. I do have to apologize for a couple that we still get a huge demand for from architects and commercial trade. One of them is Nicelia or Stipa tenuissima, which still has never, I've never seen it go into nature, but it's pretty aggressive coming up around town and stuff like that. And another one is, well, the freeway fountain grass, right? Okay, which we don't grow. We grow a seed sterile version of that that actually has the beautiful green leaves and a pink tassel. It's actually beautiful. Seeds, sterile green fountain grass. It's beautiful. And nothing goes to seed. We've actually introduced several other grasses that are either extremely low seed viability or seed sterile. The one that I brought today doesn't look like much. And frankly, I'm so old, it's going to take me about 3 minutes to remember its name. This used to happen faster when I was in my 30s. Ligeum spartum. Ligeum spartum. And this is a new grass that we've introduced to the trade last year. It is really cool because it is a very drought-tolerant, water-wise ornamental grass, which a lot of grasses aren't. So you'll find this growing in our southwest garden, where we have cactus and wildflowers and perennials. And what's pretty about it is it only gets to be about 2 feet tall. And then the flower thing on it is a little husk. It almost looks like a little flat cachucha, that's Spanish for cap. Okay, looks like a little paper cap. And it gets covered with these cool little paper caps. We've grown it for 3 years now and we've never seen one come up from seed, which is a really good sign of low seed viability. We also developed and introduced a grass that gets to be about this tall, kind of like what everybody had hoped pampas grass would be back in the 60s. It's not quite as fluffy. But you know, I mean, do you remember? I know that your grandparents told you about this because none of us are old enough to remember, but I remember when pampas grass, man, that was the exotic thing. Everybody wanted one, right? Okay, well, there's a family of grasses called miscanthus, or the maiden grasses. And the drawbacks of most miscanthus are is they die in the winter. Even in Southern California, they're dormant. They go deciduous. The other drawback is the only flower with those soft, feathery little tassels in August and September and not all that much of a show. Well, we developed a miscanthus called miscanthus sentinel. And it's seed sterile. And it grows very quickly to 5 feet tall. And it's evergreen. And it produces its flowers almost all year round. So you always have this beautiful tall grass with these flowing feathery tassels. Not as feathery as as pampas grass. And certainly not invasive. So now you've got a grass that you can make loose borders or hedges with, just with that softness and with the movement in the breeze. It's a fantastic, beautiful grass. The grasses, again, almost all grasses, we cut them down to the ground at least once or twice a year. Why? Because they fill up with thatch, that papery thatch inside. So buzz it down. It's a hard job. On a mature grass, it's very, very difficult to do. How do you do it? Really, the best way is a weed eater with a brush blade on it, okay? Or sometimes the power hedge shears. Just be careful, don't hurt yourself. But if you cut your grasses down once or twice a year, then you'll never have that thatch buildup. Another thing that people don't know about ornamental grasses is they can be very fire dangerous, even when they're green, because of that thatch buildup. So if you're on a border area where wildfire could be a factor, you know, a border area like Rancho Santa Fe or Fairbanks Ranch. Nobody ever thought that was, right? And fire burned all the way down almost to the ocean. But anyway, by doing that once or twice a year cut down, then you won't have them be so fire susceptible. Because don't ask me how I know, okay? Is there anybody here who works for the fire department? Okay. I grew up in the mountains, and in farming and ranching, burning is part of the natural process. You would burn pastures, for example. You would burn to clear vegetation along irrigation ditches and things like that. I don't know, or never have I heard of anybody who will occasionally set fire to his ornamental grasses in his landscape around his home. But I did notice that even the very lush looking green grasses will produce this beautiful 10 to 12 foot torch of flames. This is Lygium spartum, and the tall one that I described to you is Miscanthus sentinel. I don't think you'll find either one of those grasses anywhere else. This one we didn't develop, but it just hasn't been in the trade, and Miscanthus sentinel is our own development. Yes, ma'am?
How broad would that Lygium grow?
The Lygium is a clumping grass, so it's not invasive by crawling either, and it just stays in a nice clump about a foot and a half to 2 feet wide. And same with the Miscanthus. It's not invasive by crawling or runners or spreading. It just makes this beautiful tall clump. Okay. Well, we've gone through a lot of things, and we've had some fun. Yes, any more questions?
How do you take care of blue festuca?
How do you take care of blue festuca?
Yeah, can you cut that?
The question is, how do you take care of that beautiful blue festuca? I usually like a bobcat or a bulldozer, and because here's the problem. Blue festuca hates our climate. If you lived up by Lake Tahoe, where I grew up as a youngster, you would never have any problem with it, because it has cool nights even in the summertime. And so the roots don't rot and the whole clump does not collapse. But in Southern California, they hate our warm summer nights. They need cold temperatures, and they just do poorly, and they eventually will rot out on you in patches and clumps and be a disaster. If you want a bluish colored grass that grows in clumps and gets about this high and loves our climate and is very durable and will give you years of service, then you'll want to come to a place called Waterwise Botanicals, and you can ask for Cesslaria nitida. Cesslaria nitida. It's a great Southern California substitute for a blue gray grass. Pardon me?
Spelling.
Oh, spelling.
C-E-R-S.
S-E-S-L-E-R-I-A, and then nitida. N-I-T-I-D-A. E-I-E-I-O. You saw that commercial, right? Why the farmer Clem can never win a spelling test? Cat. C-A-T-E-I-E-I-O. Which reminds me of another. A friend of mine went and visited New York just a little while back, and he came back, and I asked him how he liked it, because I really don't like big cities, and I've never been to New York, but he told me, he said, well, I went to Grand Central Park one time while I was there, and I hadn't gotten very far when this bad guy came up and hit me on the head, and he stole my watch. He goes, and then I went walking some more, and I didn't get very much further down, and another bad guy came along, and he knocked me over, and he stole my wallet. And then I was walking down a little further, and a bad guy came along, and he stole my sunglasses. Gee. Sure was muggy that day. Okay, yes, ma'am.
Have you a garrote bug problem?
Pardon me?
Bug garrote bug problems.
I don't know that critter. So I guess
nasty.
Not. Yeah, don't know that
anymore. Second question. Yes,
ma'am.
How often do you water lavender?
That's a great question. Lavenders, again, as you all know, are a failure to thrive in Southern California. They hate it. They hate our summers. That's always when they die, right? You walk out, you see your lavenders, and you start going, oh, it looks a little sad. And that compassionate mama's heart, daddy's heart in you sometimes goes, I will help you, and you put a little water on them. And the next day you walk out, and they're dead. If you lived in an alpine community like Julian, they would thrive. They need, again, the cold nighttime temperatures, the cool nighttime temperatures in the summer. They hate our warm nights. They root rot. So how do you grow them in Southern California? Most people grow them by planting them frequently, pulling them out frequently, and replacing them frequently. Now, I don't mean to be sarcastic, because I'm going to give you a solution. Okay?
Yeah.
But anyway, that's kind of the cycle. It's really hard to successfully have long-term lavenders. Actually, some of the ones that will do best is if they can be in some part or filtered shade, even though you think of them as a full sun plant, but that keeps those summertime, nighttime temperatures cooler. That'll help a little bit. Don't water them very much. Don't have much sympathy for them. You know, just kind of walk on by when you think you were going to water them. That'll help. But there's no guarantee. It's not a long-term situation with most lavenders in Southern California. We're introducing a new salvia called Salvia farinaceae. Think faux lavender. It has a great smell. It's got the really pretty bluish, purplish flowers. It loves our climate. You can water it a lot. You can water it hardly at all. It thrives, grows very fast, and it loves to be mowed to the ground after it's established. You can mow it to the ground two or three times a year, and it just looks like lavender. In fact, we're just about getting ready to trademark a common name for it. We're going to call it, don't tell anybody, Lavender Fields. Salvia farinaceae, Lavender Fields. And it will be the answer and solution to lavender disappointment in Southern California. Any other questions? We all good? Yes, ma'am.
How do you spell that, please?
How do I spell what?
Salvia.
Oh, Salvia farinaceae? Oh, you're killing me. I'm actually a very good speller, but I can't spell in the air because I'm dyslexic in the air. So let's try it. Farinaceae. F-A-R-I-N-A-C-E-A-E. Or something like that. It's also called sometimes Texas purple sage or Texas blue sage, something like that. You should be able to pull it up somehow by Googling it that way. You won't find it described in our website yet because we're just preparing it as a new crop introduction. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question about valerian. Up in the Bay Area, specifically around Berkeley, the university, there is a gorgeous cultivar that is lavender.
Yes.
Really beautiful. Going to seed all over an empty lot. So naturally, I brought some seed home, planted it, turned out pink.
Okay. So she has a question about valerian. And she found it growing around a university, and she stole some of it. And she brought it home. She brought it home, and it turned out pink instead of purple. And the reason for that is that crime doesn't pay. Now I have a question for you.
Okay.
What the hell is valerian? I don't know that plant. I'm sorry.
Jupiter's beard.
Oh, is that Jupiter's beard?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So Jupiter's beard comes in different colors.
Right.
You'll find it kind of a ruby red.
Right.
You'll find it in pink, and you'll find it in white. I've never seen a violet or purple, but I'm not saying it can't happen. We actually reproduce ours vegetatively to get the colors we want.
Okay.
So we root cuttings of the white and the purple and the red.
Okay.
And thank you for teaching me another name for that. I didn't know that. Great. Okay.
Anybody
else? Yes, ma'am.
Question, back to your salvia, lavender fields.
Yes.
How high,
wide
does it grow?
It grows, go ahead. I'm sorry. My wife tells me I do this all the time. You're interrupting me before I get finished. I'm so sorry. Please finish your question.
And a blooming period.
Okay, blooming period's almost all year round. Height is about 2 to 2.5 feet. Some potential for flop. That's why we cut it to the ground a couple of times a year. And width can be up to 3 feet eventually, but it's not particularly stoloniferous or creeping. It just gets wide. And if you want to see some established plants of it, then drive out towards our place. That would be waterwisebotanicals.com. And you'll drive past a place called Champagne Lakes RV Village, who had us do landscape design and project management for them. And they planted very nice specimens of it in their entryway gardens as it wraps and wanders along the creek that's underneath the sycamore trees and the California Bay laurels and all kinds of other cool, pretty plants. Yes, ma'am.
Can
Hollis Castle, Artemisia, any of the Artemisia?
Yes, how would you prune Artemisia at Hollis Castle? That's really, it looks ratty sometimes, doesn't it? Yeah. That is a plant that loves to be pruned. So prune it a lot and frequently, and whenever you feel like it, and whenever you can get your husband to get out there and stop watching the football game, because the more you prune it, the fuller and nicer it'll be. And it's very drought tolerant, very wonderful aromatic foliage, and it just likes to be pruned frequently. Otherwise, you get the deadish stems underneath with just little ends of foliage. Any other questions?
Do you sell it?
Yes, we do sell it. Yes. At Waterwise Botanicals.
Do you have California natives at all?
Okay, do we have California natives at all? Some people ask me if I'm one. Because I have been here for 39 years. But I still only claim to be just visiting. Because I am a northern Nevadan. I grew up Nevadan. I go back 3 generations native northern Nevadan, both my mom and dad's side. I am not a native Californian. When I came down here and saw the native plants in the native hills around here, I was shocked and aghast. I have to tell you, I don't think they're pretty. Because I grew up with pine trees, manzanita, aspens. I'm sorry, I just apologize. In fact, where we had horse pastures up there, they were green. It's an exciting concept. So I'm not dissing y'all. And I don't mind, and I go on hikes. Some of the stuff smells good. There's a few plants I like. I like Rus integrifolia and Rus ovata, and I like heteromeles, and I like Matilla hapapis. And in fact, I have a rose that has single white petals that looks like a Matilla hapapi on a rose bush called Sharon's Delight. Okay, so there's some things I like. I'm not prejudiced. But I don't do natives. Couple reasons why. Not a lot of them fascinate me. And second of all, most California natives are extremely difficult for people to bring into cultivation. They're kind of like lavender, only a lot of them are worse. So some things work, some of them are okay, some of them are good. I have a nemesis. Have you guys watched Seinfeld ever? You know, Newman? Where every time you cross in the hallway, you go, Newman. And then I go, Jerry. Okay, so I have a nemesis out there. He's a fine gentleman. He's an expert in natives. He doesn't like me, okay? And he's said things over the internet, stuff like that, because we have this rivalry, because he knows that I don't like natives. And so whenever we cross paths, it's like, Reuben. Jesch. And it's become a respectable thing. We respect each other. Go ahead.
How to not kill potted Matilla hapapis in green.
Oh. How to not kill potted Matilla hapapis. That's actually a challenge that I have not succeeded at very well, but I know how to do it. Again, don't water them. Let them get really bone dry in between waterings, and especially in the summertime, in the warm season. Second thing is, buy them in the fall, plant them during the cool season, and don't try to grow them in a container, because it's really hard, really almost impossible. Yes, ma'am.
Any tips if you've already got them on digging them up and moving them to another area?
Again, very, very difficult. So do it in the cool season when they're actively growing, like around December, and when things are rainy and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Try to dig up a clump of rhizomes, so there's a lot of soil and rhizomes that never got disturbed. Move the whole clump, drop it in a new spot, and during the wintertime, water it. They actually like that during the cool growing season. And it'll take hold. Yes, ma'am.
Do you have any ideas for a ground cover for an area 6 feet wide and 45 feet long?
Do you have any ideas for a ground cover 6 feet wide and 45 feet long?
Long.
I normally would recommend artificial turf. But then one day I came to a property and they showed me what the hell artificial gophers look like. And if you haven't had the crap scared out of you yet, wow. I personally don't like ground cover. To me, ground cover is another word for weeds. You know how you plant nice stuff, you know, some shrubs and some perennials and some things like that? And then you plant ground cover all around it. And what happens in 2 or 3 years? The ground cover is tangling up with everything, getting in everything, dying off in patches, mm-hmm. growing over places where you don't want it to, crawling over the sidewalk. To me, ground cover plants are weeds. And most ground cover plants were not meant to be durable or beautiful past that first year or so, because they're not permanent plants. So when we landscape, I say, what permanent landscape do I want to cover your strip with? Now, if you tell me low, then I can pick you a beautiful plant palette of maybe succulents or maybe of flowering perennials. You tell me the direction you're feeling, and we select permanent low-growing shrubs, low-growing perennials, low-growing succulents, and create a tapestry or a patchwork mosaic quilt in drifts. And that's the other thing important, especially you collector knuckleheads. You want to have one of everything. And so when people drive by your yards, their brains just like fizz out because there's just too much to absorb. There's too much going on. When you're doing landscaping principles, you want to have some massing and some drifting so that there's power and intention to a wave of color or texture or contrast. And so when you're really thinking landscaping-wise, you have to think of it as that painting. And if you got too much going on, it's just disruptive and it makes you crazy. But if you're telling a story, like on a canvas, where you're using color for power and impact and contrast and things like that, now you can create a really beautiful landscape. And so if you gave me your spot, I'd make it beautiful, but I wouldn't use ground cover. Yes?
Would you use a rooting hormone if you were trying to propagate ceanothus?
Would I use a rooting hormone if I was trying to propagate ceanothus? Yes and no. The answer is yes, because it will help with the rooting process. It has to be done during the cool season, and it's very hard to do. And no, because ceanothus was supposed to be a great landscaping plant, and millions of them were sold in the 80s and 90s as being the drought-tolerant answer, and very few of those are alive today. Again, trying to bring a California native into the landscape and cultivation is hard. And the other thing is, California native does not mean great in Southern California. I hate to tell y'all, but manzanitas and ceanothus frequently come from alpine climates, Northern California, coastal, where it's constantly cool. And everybody goes, oh boy, we're going to bring these California natives and plant them in our garden in Southern California for water-wise consciousness. And you go out there and your water-wise conscious plants are unconscious. In fact, they're dead. Because they're not built for our salty water and our warm climates. Okay, anything else? We're about cool? Okay, I'm just going to tell you one thing. Any plant up here in a container, I'll sell. Any plant that's been depotted, bare-rooted, hacked on, chopped up, y'all can fight over.
Go get it.
Thank you very much.